Yesterday, it was announced that only one officer would face charges in connection with the shooting incident that killed Breonna Taylor, but not for her actual death. The charges are for shooting into an apartment belonging to one of Taylor's neighbors. That's what the officer charged is being held accountable for. Back in March, Taylor was shot to death in her apartment as officers entered looking for a drug suspect. Turns out that suspect did not live at her apartment and had actually been arrested before they came to her home. Taylor's boyfriend says police did not identify themselves, so he called 911 for help and fired at the men coming in because he thought their apartment was getting broken into. But yesterday, the Kentucky Attorney General said officers did announce themselves. Attorney Mark Reichel with us to navigate the legalities here. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
First, several different potential charges were put to a grand jury. Once that grand jury was impaneled and made its decision, could Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron have done anything different after their decision if he wanted to?
You know, you don't have to use a grand jury. You can charge people by a criminal complaint, and then you have to give that defendant, those people charged, what's called a preliminary examination, where a judge determines, kind of like a mini trial, whether there's enough to hold you over and to go to trial later on. They often use grand juries for one reason, and one reason only, is to get it away from, you know, public scrutiny, from public pressure, to get the grand jury to be able to do their business without anybody interfering with it. And so that's why they went to a grand jury in this case. You know, it's my understanding he did present some of the other charges that could have been brought. Kentucky law is very favorable to law enforcement in situations like this. And as a result, the grand jury indictment on just one is absolutely, in my opinion, going to be the end of the story here. And there's just one officer who's going to go to trial.
And so once that grand jury makes his decision, there's not a function of the law that allows him to go in a different direction. He has to abide by that.
There is, to be honest with you. You can say, well, look, the grand jury didn't do this, but I'm the prosecutor. I'm going to file a criminal complaint, file it, charge them with whatever you want. And within a certain period of time, a quick period of time, they're entitled to a preliminary examination or a prelim or a preliminary hearing where a judge hears the evidence. That takes the function of a grand jury. So prosecutors in the past in this country and in this state have got a no bill or no holding order from a grand jury and then went ahead and charged anyway, and let the preliminary examination determine whether or not there's enough to go to trial. A grand jury indictment is really just a charging decision that there's enough to go to trial.
So just to get your sense of things here, whether or not politics have come to play, there's been a lot of chatter on social media about the fact that Cameron is a Republican and actually was announced as being on President Trump's short list for Supreme Court nominations. And then since Trump has been very much on the side of law enforcement and situations like this, that Cameron sided with the officers. Looking at the law, looking at the case, what's your sense of things?
I think this was a slanted or sided biased prosecution by Mr. Cameron, the Attorney General of Kentucky. First of all, this happened in March, and it took a lot of public pressure, international public pressure, as well as the George Floyd protests, to bring this individual forward, the Attorney General of Kentucky, to even consider charging these officers. This evidence has been out since March. It wasn't here until late September that the Attorney General of Kentucky decided to bring it to a grand jury. And in this case, there's a lot that was not given to the grand jury, specifically some of the cover-up. And you only cover things up when you're worried, when you've made a mistake. It's called consciousness of guilt. It means you know you're guilty or have done something wrong. Some of the reports were backdated, were altered. There were complete lies in some of the reports. And very importantly, the officers and the police chief immediately said, this unit doesn't wear body cameras. They don't wear body cameras. Photographs appeared shortly thereafter of them, shortly after the raid, and one was wearing a body camera, and another one had a spot where the body camera normally goes. So there were several things that appear to be a cover-up that wasn't presented to the grand jury.
All righty, and we are getting short on time, but just quickly, given the fact that we've had this decision by the grand jury, only one officer charged, and then the fact that the family has already settled with the city for $12 million, still calls for justice. Is there any option left for them to take, or is this in effect over?
No. The Department of Justice, actually, the Attorney General can come in and do a civil rights criminal investigation like they did in the Rodney King case, if we remember, in California in the early 90s, late 80s. The officers were acquitted after trial in state court. The feds came in, actually charged the officers, and convicted them in federal court. That could happen. It'll only happen if the Democrats take the White House in November and in January with a new Attorney General. Attorney General Barr has advised he will not get involved in doing that in this case.
All righty. Thank you so much, Mark, for giving us your insight about the legalities in this case.
Always my pleasure.